expose them to the good stuff. And it's just like you said, they never get tired of the good stuff. She may say to Grace, who would ever get tired of that? The real great classes are the things. And kids, you can't pull the wool over their eyes. They know what's good and what's not. And so we don't need to water it down for them, but we want to expose them to what is good. And I remember when we would get doing our housework at home, we had put on Bach Brandenburg concertos because those were that pretty. They were energetic and they would get the work done and they were hearing classical music for the same at the time, and it was kind of a really funny bit. So, you know, you could make your choice of what you're going to expose them to. The second thing that Einstein did was he started by having his students sing. And singing is so intuitive and natural for children, and that is the right place to start. Kodály says that the singing voice is the first instrument. And they learn to sing just like they learn how to speak the mother tongue by listening to us, by listening to others. And I don't know if any of you have heard young children singing while they're playing. Isn't that the most joyful experience? I remember one of my daughters, she was out on the glider swing outside, she was swinging along and she was singing at the top of her voice. It was so joyful. And I've heard a couple of my grandchildren, the one will sing the stories. She doesn't read yet, but she will take the storybook because she's read to them a lot. And then she'll sing the stories. Then I have another grandchild who will sit down at the piano and just improvise and then just sing her thoughts while she's accompanying herself on the piano. These are joyful, unstructured, but totally a musical expression, these experiences. And when we encourage our children to sing by singing with them and to them and with them, we are preparing them for musical education and receiving the joy of music. And if you're not confident with your own singing voice, I know I always thought that I became a violinist so I wouldn't have to sing, you know, because I wasn't that confident with mine, but you don't have to worry about how good it sounds. You just start out with something. Singing games are great, and it's an appropriate beginning, I think, for children in their music education. Their first musical experiences and a great preparation for learning a musical instrument. And I think that's what they do in kinder music and lots of singing, and certainly in a Kodály curriculum. It's always the singing first, and learning the elements of music first, and then taking it to the instrument instead of vice versa. Putting a finger down, the music comes out, and then you know what it sounds like. Now, that's turned around. His philosophy was you have it inside yourself first, and then you can reproduce it on the instrument. So when the time comes to start learning a musical instrument, parents need to appreciate that it takes work. Right? You teachers all know this, so we can do the choir to succeed, just like any sport or skill. Children are not born into this world knowing how to work and wanting to do it. Just human nature for all of us to shun labor, isn't it? If you have something hard to do, if you want to think of something else and just kind of put it off because you just don't want to have to think that hard. I mean, it's just a natural thing for all of us. So why should we think that our children are any different? But that is one of the best reasons for becoming a musician, is to gain the understanding of how to succeed at anything. So we parents and teachers must teach our children how to practice and help them develop that tenacity and patience that it requires. And most successful musicians had involved parents growing up. And I have to remember the story I heard from the great cellist, Zara Nelsova. She grew up in Canada. Her father was a musician and she had two sisters. Zara was a cellist, her sister played the piano, and another sister played the violin. So they had a piano trio in their family. And she said that her father was the one who taught them how to practice, but they only had one room to practice in, and so one was in each corner of the room. Can you imagine the intense powers of concentration that they had to develop? You know, what, listening to each other, but having to focus on their own individual work. But under those circumstances, not ideal, their father taught them how to practice. They became terrific. Here's a quote from Sublet Scott, who's a clarinetist from the Oklahoma City Symphony. He says, "No teacher, regardless of how gifted or efficient, can supervise what takes place between the lessons. All too often, parents expect a buy musical education for their child by paying for lessons, the instrument, and other equipment, and assume that the teacher will do the rest. You teachers, I probably heard about that. Of course, the teacher will do all he can, all that can be done to make the learning easy and attractive. But the fact is that the physical skills involved in playing the instrument require a certain amount of time and effort, and no progress is possible without it. When the pupil arrives at the lesson unprepared, he cannot experience, along with the others in the group, the sweet thrill of success. So that's a punch for parents to understand that really success takes some supervision, because children are children. So I'm going to suggest that you practice with your children